Good evening and welcome to Conservative Chat, a show brought to you by the Barkhamsted Republican Town Committee. My name is Juliana Simone, and my guest this evening is our fine state representative, William Simanski.
Hiya.
Hi, Bill. How you doing?
Pleased to be here. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm pleased you're here, too. So Bill represents our town of Barkhamsted, Heartland, Granby, and New Hartford.
Yes, I do.
Three of those four towns get the show, mm-hmm. which is nice. And I'll bring this over to Granby.
Good.
So all your people there can watch you, including your wife, right?
Yes.
Who probably wants to watch. So I haven't talked to you really since session ended. I see you a lot, but I mean, I haven't had you on the show. So tell me about last session and what your favorite thing about that was.
Right. Well, last session is well known as a historic event, and it really was. And the reason was that we actually had a bipartisan budget. Now, you have to understand what had happened, that our Republican budget actually passed the Senate because three moderate senators voted for it. It passed the Senate, then it came down to the House, where we're still a minority, and five moderate Democrats voted for the Republican budget. So we actually had a Republican budget that passed the legislature and went to the governor. He vetoed it. But then the budget came back to the legislature to craft a budget that would be veto-proof. And the Democrats had to talk to us, and the foundation for the budget was, of course, the Republican principles. As a result of that, we got a spending cap, something we promised the voters in 91 after the income tax. We finally got it. We got a bonding cap that limits the amount of our borrowing. We got a volatility cap, so if a whole bunch of extra money comes in, like when the offshore accounts had to be repatriatized this year, that was $600 million that has to go in the rainy day fund. And we get the vote on all future union contracts. So these are really the fundamental changes that we need to start turning the state of Connecticut away from that fiscal cliff and start to rescue it. I'm excited about it.
Those are some really big changes.
Very big.
Because you guys could never have anything to say with the union negotiations. That's a big one.
Right. Now, we're locked into union contracts until 2027, mm-hmm. thanks to the governor and the majority party. But even though we are, we still can make changes because every year 2,000 employees retire from state government, don't replace them. That's a substantial saving right there.
Okay.
There's also a lot of middle management in state government. In the public private sector, it's like 12 to 1 or sometimes 10 to 1 as far as supervisor to employee. State government is 5 to 1.
Uh-huh.
That's ridiculous. We're over heavy with supervisory. Plus, there's a lot of commissioners, district commissioners, assistant this, assistant that. A lot of them are political appointees. They are not unionized, and we can limit or reduce the size of government.
Yeah, those are usually friends of, you know, the person in charge.
Yes.
You know, it's friends of Obama when he had all those czars, and
yes.
friends of Malloy, and they get them positions.
Yes.
So good. Yeah, there's always a lot of that surplus waste, you know,
yes.
in terms of overstaffing that you can reduce.
Right. Also, one of the things we as Republicans were pushing for, let's actually abide by what our auditors of public accounts have found when they audit every single State Department. Some of their recommendations, like, wow, why aren't we doing that? If we do, we can save the state of Connecticut millions of dollars.
Right.
So I'm really hopeful for the next session that we can really build upon what we started and really rescue the state of Connecticut and put it on the right path.
And I remember when your numbers were smaller, they wouldn't even talk to you guys.
Correct.
And I remember when Larry Cafiero was the House Minority Leader, and poor Bob Ward, I think, even had smaller numbers prior to him, you guys would always offer a better solution budget.
Right.
And you'd get some press out of it. Maybe, of course, never as much as the other side, but mm-hmm. you'd get some press out of it. And I remember if you were in the LOB, he'd always have up on an easel. You
know, do that.
Yeah, you know, all the checklist of the things that your budget, the Republican caucus, would do.
Right.
But they wouldn't even meet with you and discuss it.
Right.
It was always a closed door thing. So the fact that I think you've made these gains you're so close in the House and tied in the Senate. Mm-hmm. They had to listen this time. And fortunately, some of the more moderate Democrats that are sensible and realize, you know, the state's in such debt and mm-hmm. dire need for a solution, so they voted with you guys.
Yes.
That's real progress.
It is.
For Connecticut and the General Assembly.
It's interesting because when I knock on doors and talk to voters, they, you know, I'm leaving Connecticut as soon as my kids get out of high school and go to college, or as soon as I retire, I'm leaving Connecticut. But I leave them on the note of optimism. Look what we did last year. I sincerely believe we can turn the state of Connecticut around. They say, okay, maybe I'll stick around a little longer. And when I say, you know, we got a bipartisan agreement, why haven't you done it in the past? Then when I explain to them about the, you know, one-party rule for the past 40 years, they say, oh, okay, I get it.
Yeah. Right, and, you know, unless you're in politics like we are, mm-hmm. you know, or just have a real armchair interest in them, a lot of the voters don't know.
No, they don't.
The specifics of why the state's in its situation, or mm-hmm. so it's good that you get the message out. I love when you guys do doors, you know. Tell me about you just finished four terms, right? You're seeking re-election to your fifth.
That's correct.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, I can't believe that much time's gone by.
Yeah, 8 years.
You know why? Because you do such a good job, in my opinion.
Thank you.
You just always are so. You're always, you have great communication skills. I mean, you're not someone that doesn't answer your email or calls. You're always very attentive to everything going on in your four towns in your district. You're in touch with all your constituents, regardless
yes.
of party,
mm-hmm.
and there to help. So, I mean, with Bill there, I mean, I know, you'd have to realize that you would notice if you had a bad representative, right? Because, you know, you'd
sure.
be unhappy. Things that you've complained about or called about, you wouldn't, you know, nothing would be getting done about it. But see, we never hear that about you because you just do such a good job. It's just been seamless.
Right. I'm very proud that quite a few Democrats have stepped forward. In fact, in the Granby Drummer, there was just an endorsement from a lifelong Democrat supporting me. Several Democrats have contacted me, and they said exactly what, you know, Bill, you've always been there for us. You're very responsive. You answer all your emails and phone calls personally. So I'm proud of that, quite frankly.
I agree. We're happy you're our state rep.
Thank you.
Now, another exciting thing that just happened for you was the Republican American, or Waterbury Republican, for some
right.
of you. I know that Earl like to call it the Waterbury. They just endorsed you in the House races.
They did.
I think they always have, haven't they?
Yes.
But you haven't been opposed all the time. So
correct.
Maybe I think then you just make the little list. They always
mm-hmm.
have a little list at the bottom of
right.
Either side, any state reps or mm-hmm. senators that are running unopposed. But I liked that endorsement very much. Did you want to read it for us?
I do. And I'm a little upset because my the person who is opposing me is running a negative campaign. She's saying some things that are not quite true about me. She accuses me of being anti-women. Hey, I married my high school sweetheart. We've been married for 46 years. Ask her if I'm anti-woman. Please give me a break. And in the Waterbury Republican, as a matter of fact, she lists her occupation as a community organizer, and she lists her experience as political newcomer. Not exactly what we need here in the state of Connecticut.
No. I told you that the Republican town committee, my members asked me, you mm-hmm. know, what community did she organize? And that I don't think anyone knows that answer. And then also, why would our four rural towns that are so suburban and
right.
family-oriented, where people just go to work and raise their kids and the mm-hmm. kids are in school, or they volunteer for community activities. It's very peaceful here. I don't really know
yeah.
what kind of organizing would need to be done, I yeah. guess is my point.
Yeah. So I think if voters are trying to decide who to vote for the 62nd district representative, I think the Republican American endorsement says it all.
Okay, let's listen.
It says, Ms. Webster, a former teacher, which is untrue also, is an unabashed progressive. Among other things, she favors a higher minimum wage, soak the rich taxation, paid family leave, and taxing marijuana. This is not what Connecticut needs in the face of his current challenges. Voters should stick with Representative Simanski, who has compiled a reliably conservative voting record on a host of issues and has been active in the community.
Yeah, excellent. It said it all.
It does.
When I saw it, I said, woohoo! You know, I just thought that was, I thought it was perfect. So congratulations
you.
On that.
Thank you.
And I know, too, I didn't ask you, I should have done that. I should have printed it out, but I saw that one of my committee members, who's, I think, personal activity here in town is he likes to always keep a hand on the Northwestern Regional 7 budget. Mm-hmm. That's his primary preoccupation. But Tom Palmer wrote a very nice letter to the editor for you
in
the Republican American, and that was published Sunday, I believe. Is that Sunday? In the Sunday paper?
No, I think it was actually yesterday.
Was it yesterday?
Yeah, someone.
Did we bring that?
Unfortunately, no.
Oh, okay, rats. I know, that was an afterthought for me because, I have it on my phone, I suppose, but I'd have to get off the table and get my phone. But it was very complimentary, too.
It was.
About how hands-on you are, how well you've served the district for so many years, and there was just absolutely no reason not to reelect you. So that was. Tom went to Cornell. He's a learned man. He's a successful businessman. So that was high praise from Tom.
Good. Thank you.
You're welcome. So yes, I did see something on Facebook. You know, something about your opponent saying that she had an associate degree, but she didn't because she just went for 1 year to community college in New Hampshire.
Right. She says that she has an associate certificate in early childhood education. Now, she graduated high school, says the class of 2007. She went to a New Hampshire community college, and in 2008, so 1 year, she got an associate certificate in childhood education. There is no such thing. In 1 year, you don't get an associate's degree or a certificate or anything else like that. So people have questioned, and I said, look, I don't know, but...
Yeah, we don't know her very well or any of that. So the ballot's interesting this year, but yeah, I mean, you can't really fudge about stuff like that when you're running for office. You know that. I mean, I ran way back in 06, and yeah, you've got to be very honest and candid about it. Because people, especially if you're running against someone, they'll research it.
Yes.
Because then, you know, I'm a political campaign worker, so we did intel all the time.
You have to.
Opponents that... we're in our own caucus and seeking a nomination, and then certainly afterwards, the opposing caucus. So, all that stuff's pretty easy to look up these days. Now, I want to talk to you about the ballot because the ballot's interesting. Because for the first time, we have ballot initiative, which I was familiar with the 14 years I lived in California. That was interesting. And we'd have 7, 8, 9 questions.
Yes.
And it was interesting too to learn. That even the public always resoundingly seemed to vote in the same way. But that's when California started, that's when they decided, as they got more progressive, they started learning, well, we'll just have some appeal judge, some court, you know, judge, appeal what the voters just voted for on the proposition. They just turn it over and get what they wanted anyway. So I'm hoping it doesn't go. They should listen to the voters, and I hope they don't start doing that here. But so it's exciting to have a couple of questions on the ballot this year. The viewers should be aware of that you have a couple of questions to answer as well. And so one of them, one of them is about protecting the land, right? That's land use.
Right. That's ballot question two.
Okay. And explain that to us.
Right. Well, first let's talk about ballot question one, because people have asked me about that, too. It's about a constitutional transportation lockbox. And we've had a lockbox, a legislative lockbox in the state of Connecticut that's supposed to prevent the governor and the legislature from raiding money from the Special Transportation Fund. not a special transportation fund, your gas taxes, your grocery receipt taxes, and other DMV expenses and stuff like that. That goes into a special transportation fund supposed to be used exclusively for transportation infrastructure, our roads, our bridges, et cetera, et cetera. Except even though we have a legislative lockbox, every year it's raided. Hundreds of millions of dollars, ever since I've been in the legislature.
Yeah, I agree with you. It's been that way a long time.
Right. They take it out. Now, the ballot question one is, should there be a constitutional transportation lockbox? And even though it's not ironclad, the language in it, it's still, since it has the force of the constitutional amendment behind it, hopefully that'll make the the more progressive people think twice about reaching into that money that that the citizens believe is going to use for transportation infrastructure. So slap on your hand, right, don't do it.
Right, because Connecticut just made another one of those lists. Yes. We always do nationwide. That I think, again, we were in the top 10 for the worst infrastructure. Our bridges were the most run down, our highways and roads had the most potholes,
right,
all of those things.
So I would encourage,
so that's how that happens, is because,
sure,
the transportation fund, right, is always raided.
So I would encourage everyone to vote yes on number one.
Vote
Let's
yes
get
on
that.
One.
Amend the Constitution to have a lockbox for the special transportation fund.
Okay.
Now the second question is to preserve our public lands. And the impetus behind this was the infamous Haddam land swap, where there was a very valuable property, a lakefront property, that the town of Haddam was going to swap with a developer who wanted to put housing and everything that's in there, even though it was supposed to be a preserve area, and give them like a gravel pit or something that was, you know, absolutely useless. That's going to be the swap. Fortunately, even though some of the legislature voted for it, it fell apart. This amendment gives the voters the right to have a public hearing on any time we're going to sell public land. And then, even if it's approved, then it has to be approved by two-thirds of the vote of the entire legislature. So really, it really preserves public land for the reason it should be.
Okay.
So, again, I would vote everyone to vote in favor of it. It's a good thing. It preserves public land for public use.
Okay. Very good.
Yes.
And a two-thirds majority, that's...
Yes.
That
assures that if it's
going
to be sold, it's for the absolutely right reason.
Okay, good. So that's interesting to learn. And so again, when you're filling in your ballots, don't forget to answer these questions. And Bill is suggesting you vote yes, and for those reasons.
Yes.
Because you can read that language. And because when we were at the Riverton booth, we had the actual bill on the booth. But unless you're familiar with all the statutes and all the language that you guys read all the time, people were kind of just looking at it, not really understanding it.
Certainly.
Which I understand. So I'm glad that you explained that to us. Thank you.
Good.
Let's talk about, so what do you think of the governor's race right now? The new Quinnipiac poll came out today and said Bob Stefanowski, the Republican candidate, is closing the gap on Ned Lamont, the Democrat candidate, to like a 3 to 4 point spread that's not really something that's in stone anyway, and then they gave Oz Griebel 7%.
Right.
Percent.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Early on, the gap was much wider.
Yes.
And I think Stefanowski, as more people get to understand who he is, what he's what his principles and what he's advocating for, the more they get to understand that, I think the more people will say, hey, this is the person I want as governor. I personally support him, and for very good reason. Part of his job was to rehabilitate broken companies. Connecticut is broken. We need someone who can fix a broken state.
Right.
So he's the man for the job. Now, a lot of people will say, well, you know, that's fine. He's a businessman. How is he going to manage to interact with the senator? Well, Joe Markley, who's running for lieutenant governor, has been in the legislature, and you know, staunch conservative. People know him extremely well.
Yes.
The team of someone who has the legislative experience and a proven conservative history.
I agree.
Working with someone who's a businessman, together, they can save the state of Connecticut. It's exactly the team that we need.
It's a real nice team.
It is.
A very nice pairing because for anyone that feels, well, he doesn't have a legislative background, well, of course, neither Ned or Oz do. I mean, mm-hmm. Oz knows, his wife's a lobbyist, I believe, and so he's familiar with government and how it works.
Mm-hmm.
Ned's run for a couple things before, but lost,
mm-hmm.
Even within his own party.
Yes.
So, so Bob's business acumen with Senator Markley's very seasoned tenure in the Senate is really an excellent duo to vote for.
Absolutely.
Yes. And how do you see the House? You guys need how many seats?
Right now we're six away from the majority.
Wow. You guys haven't been that close in a long time.
Yeah. So, hey, I'm the eternal optimist. I can hope for the best. You know, look, a good way to look at it is that we're still a minority party, even though we had a tie in the Senate. The lieutenant governor always cast the tying vote.
Correct.
So we're the minority, period, end, in the legislature. We, the minority party, were able to get a bipartisan budget. Imagine what we could do if we were the majority.
Yes, you could turn the state around and keep everyone from moving away. You know, because I have to tell you, I know my share of people. You defined it perfectly in that they're either waiting for their children to finish high school
because
they're going to go away to college,
right?
So they can move. Or they're retiring and can move.
Mm-hmm.
Or there's also a group that's more, you know, maybe middle-aged professionals that can move to their profession, to their headquarters, and they can stay with their company but go to the headquarters that's in a different state. Because we lost a couple of members that way, too.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, and this is the make-or-break election.
It really is.
For the future of this state.
It really is.
For those of us that love it and want it to return to the grandeur it once had for a very long time, have those companies move back in or have new companies move in because, you know, it's a good deal for them and bring those jobs.
Yeah.
That's what
I
we
moved
need
here now. In 1987. It was a job relocation. I worked for the Hartford Insurance Company. Our headquarters were in Hartford, so they moved me up here. In 87, we were the insurance capital of the world. We were a business mecca, you know, and then all of a sudden we start, you know, regressing, and now people just can't wait to move out. Businesses are moving out because there's no predictability in our budget. Businesses need that predictability. I sincerely believe after last session we can turn the state of Connecticut around. It'll take some time. We can make it once again the great state that I moved into.
Yes, and also some of the businesses that stayed only stayed because Governor Malloy and his Democrat majority gave them the incentives to stay by giving them multi-millions of dollars to stay, or otherwise they wouldn't have. So that was also another huge expense, and I think and they had to give very little in return. It was like a promise of, you know, 10 new employees
jobs,
or something over X amount of years.
Right. So, you know, the sad part about that, too, Juliana, as I talk to a lot of businesses, 85% of the jobs in the state of Connecticut are medium to small-sized businesses. And they're saying, what about us?
Yeah.
You know, the big companies get all the money. What about us? We create all the jobs. And they feel left out, rightfully so.
True. And the bigger corporations often hire out-of-state people.
Yes.
So... Yeah. Now, I think the one good positive outlook right now in terms of jobs in Connecticut is largely due to President Trump because of all his beefing up the military that got so weakened under President Obama.
Yes.
So, and since Connecticut has so much of our business here that builds things for the military, whether it's, you know, Groton Submarine or Hamilton Sundstrand or Pratt & Whitney, that is a big boost for them.
Right. Excuse me. That's another thing we can do to turn our state around. With all the manufacturing companies coming to us and complaining, there are not people willing to work or to get educated. They'll even train these people. When a person gets, well, my wife works in the school, in the guidance department. Everybody's got to go to college. Oh, you got to go to college. Mm-hmm. Baloney. I've been speaking to the State Board of Education. I'm on the education committee. Let's set people up for success. Mm-hmm. Let them go and get a manufacturing job. You get out of high school, you go to one of these manufacturing jobs, they'll train you.
Yes.
Or you can go to one of our community colleges and get an associate degree in manufacturing. You can start out at 50 grand plus benefits versus going, you know, to get your bachelor's degree in, you know, humanities or something. Then what come out? You go out and work for McDonald's?
Well, it's just, yeah, you need, yes, it's, if you don't have some, right, I'm old enough that it was traditional for people just to get a liberal arts degree.
Right.
Which really didn't, it didn't give you a special skill. So what did you, you know, unless someone helped you out and got you a job.
Right.
There was no specific trade for that. That's why I also support the trade high schools.
Absolutely.
Those parents, the parents I know that chose not to send their kids to regional, mm-hmm. and send them to Oliver Wolcott or wherever,
sure.
around here, whatever tech school it was. One of my son's friends, he's going to take over his dad's electrician's company.
Nice.
They have a lovely home. He obviously does,
yeah.
very well. So it's yeah, that should be even promoted more. I agree, and also a lot of your really wealthy self-made millionaires are people that started businesses,
right.
without college,
no.
degrees. So it's not.
I have nothing against a liberal arts degree. I got my BA in English.
That's what you want to do.
You know, exactly. I wanted to become a teacher. That's why I went and got my bachelor's degree in English. Then I was enrolled for a master's program, but unfortunately the Vietnam War intervened and I went away from my active duty. But I'm not saying nobody should go to college,
right.
but it should be your career choice.
Yes, I agree with you.
Mm-hmm.
What about, let me just have a few minutes. What do you think your favorite achievement has been as a state representative for four terms now?
Well, it's got to be last year getting that bipartisan budget through. That's the greatest thing. But as the ranking member on the banking committee, I'm really proud that we made a lot of progress in protecting the consumers with some of our credit bills that we put through. So that was really, really good. And protecting our seniors too, because with these reverse mortgages, there's a lot of bad information going out. A lot of seniors are being taken care of, and we shored up the reverse mortgage process to make sure they're adequate counsel, they fully and totally understand exactly what impact the reverse mortgage should have on their life. So I'm really proud of that too.
Yeah, that's a good one. Because I think there was a lot of misinformation with that. People
Certainly.
Didn't really understand what they were signing up
right.
for.
Hey,
so,
when you have Henry Winkler at a fund saying, go for a reverse mortgage, everybody wants to believe him. But they really have to understand what's behind a reverse mortgage.
Oh, gosh. Well, I'm excited. I mean, we're looking at a week from today.
Yes.
We're going to know, and all of you are going to know, how we're moving forward in this state, or if we're not.
Mm-hmm.
I know that our district certainly supports you, and is very pleased with your work.
Good.
And
Thank
I will
you.
Be voting for you, of course.
Thank you.
So anyone, I guess, if during this last week, if you have a question for Bill, you can certainly contact him.
Absolutely.
Because he's always available. You can.
Mm-hmm.
You have a campaign website?
I
just through the house.
Yeah, actually, it's www.Simanski2018.com or facebook.com/Simanski2018.
Okay. Yeah. So if you have a question, ask Bill before you decide. But I think you're great.
Thank you.
So, thanks for coming tonight.
Pleased to be here.
Hope there's good news on Tuesday.
So do I.
Because the state needs it. So, everyone, get out and vote. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you, Juliana.